comes, where they have this pyramid kind of a structure to break the handi. So that has become a big phenomena where each street, each gully has that dahi kind of a handi, and they prepare for it, and which one is the bigger one, and which will get the notice of the Guinness Book and so on. So it's a massive kind of preparation. She was actually focusing on a slum where there were communal riots, where there was segregation, where Muslims were sent away, where all of these guys who were doing this young youth, who were actually Dalit, they were all part of Shiv Sena, they were doing this Dahi Handi competition. So that year they won, that they would erected the biggest Dahi Handi and so on. So when she was doing this, because in the conference the Rohit name came up, and there is a paper by Arunima on Rohit, I was also speaking on Rohit. So obviously she remembered what they told her about Rohit. So the same Dahi Handi committee set up a library in the name of Rohit. Then the Shiv Sena people came to know, and they came and said, you cannot have, he is a problematic guy, he is anti-national, you cannot have Rohit library. They said, we will be part of the Dahi Handi committee, but we will have Rohit libraries in all the slums in Mumbai. So there is a huge tension within Shiv Sena because of Rohit. And imagine the kind of impact that Rohit really created, and by continuing the struggle, you really reminded the world about Rohit and the Rohit struggle. So this is the kind of struggle that you are leading. Please remember that you are leading a historic struggle. In many of the places we have been silent in our university, several universities, this is the same story. All the vice chancellors, they don't want to function according to the rules. They just want to be authoritarian. So everywhere we are facing the same kind of situation, but your struggle decides the fate of many of us. So please do continue your struggle, and that really decides our fate. But today, actually I thought I'm not going to talk about politics. I only want to mention these two anecdotes. And it's supposed to be academics, no state academics, it is academics. So I have an academic topic, so I have to talk about that particular topic. And don't mistake me that I am trying to promote my book. It so happened that the book came out, and a call came. Then I said, what will I speak? So then I said, okay, I'll speak on Dalit studies. Not because I want to promote the book, because book we have put it online. We find this Creative Commons standard, it is available freely. So you don't have to buy this. You read it, it's enough. So that is not the reason why I proposed Dalit studies. Dalit studies has some intimate connection with the kind of struggle that you are leading. So that is why I want to talk about Dalit studies today. It has connection with the public university. Supposing there is no public university, there is no Dalit studies. Supposing there is no public university, there are no Dalit students. There are no marginalized students. There are no women students. Supposing there is no public university, there is not going to be a street academics. There is no platform like this. So the private university will throw me away. They will not allow me to enter. So the Dalit studies is important in the context of public university. In the context of the kind of dream that Rohit had, that he wanted to be a science writer. He wanted to be a scholar. He wanted to be an intellectual. So this is about Dalit intellectuality. This is about the arrival of the Dalit scholar onto the scene. This is about how the Dalit scholars cannot allowed to be survived in a public university. So with the 90s, if you take that as the beginning, by the time of Rohit, they have realized that this cannot go on. This production of Dalit intellectuals in the university cannot go on. That has to stop somewhere. I remember where I was coming, the biggest battle that we fought in the 90s was what is called dropout rate. So we fought majorly, Bhavani knows about it. It's a major thing about dropout rate. What was the dropout rate? In various departments, students join, and suddenly after the first week, all the SSC students would leave. No one will remain. Even in my department, English department, out of the five joined, all left. I remained with great determination, faced a lot of difficulties. So the dropout rate was almost like 90%. So our biggest battle with the then Vice-Chancellor, Brother Raj Krishnamurthy, was about the dropout rate. So I thought we crossed the dropout rate issue. There is no dropout rate. Now you have suicide rate. So when you cross dropout, then you get into the stage where you have to commit suicide. Somehow they wanted to see that this place is not yours. You don't belong here. So that is the tragedy that the Rohit really highlighted. That the dropout rate days are over, but here you will not be allowed to survive in a university. So I think that is the context for Dalit studies. So I would like to mention two kind of context for the rise of Dalit studies. Not the book, but the Dalit studies as a field of study, a field of inquiry, or a research agenda. The first one is starting from the Mandal and the Dalit movement in the 1990s. That was a hugely important kind of a context. And if you have to take the example of your university, the idea of that at that time was, and I remember she knows, and people like Purendra Prasad and others would know, those who had fought Vijay. I think he was not there, but the Vijay from economics, all of them would know that talking politics is a crime. No politics, no posters, nothing on the walls. These all used to be very clean, and no slogan. And the leftist is supposed to be a terrorist. So there used to be, we used to think secretly, there are two leftists in the university, who? Timma Reddy and Purendra Prasad. They were there, just genius and so on. So that was the time. There was no hesitation, there was no politics, there was nothing of that. But Mandal, the Mandal report, the agitation around Mandal really broke that. And then suddenly we started putting up posters and so on. The vice chancellor decided to have separate boards because we are spoiling the hostels and so on and so forth. So that was the context where caste resurfaced in a major way. Caste resurfaced as in the form of massacres. Caste resurfaced as major forms of violence. In fact, I remember very well in the, I think last time also I mentioned this about Chunduru. Chunduru and our vice chancellor were students. Chunduru massacre happened in 1991. And the imagine, I would not imagine now, at that time, all the faculty, they have given one day salary. Except a few, that few includes this man. Because he said, you said caste Hindus killed Dalits. So I am not a caste Hindu. So I am a caste Hindu. So therefore I will not give you. So you are accusing me personally and so on and so on. So that was the context. The context of caste as atrocity. Context of caste as a language of politics. Context of caste as a national issue. Context of caste as privilege. Till that time it was called caste as a social evil. Caste is something we are not supposed to talk about. We are all citizens, friends, there is no caste divide. In the university there was no caste. So for the first time Rohit really highlighted all over the country the caste discrimination is very central to the constitution of these universities. So it was very difficult to speak even that at that time. So with the Mandal, the divide was very, 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 very clear. And caste has something that has to do with one's own identity. It's not simply a structure. It is not simply a social structure which can be objectively studied and one day you go and demolish. It is subjectively formed. Caste has something to do with a community. Caste has something to do with, caste is OBC. Caste is numbers. Caste plays an important role in elections. So many number of ways caste and the discussions around caste began, I would say, in the 1990s. That was one important context for the rise of Dalit studies. And then a lot of people think Mandal are the atrocities, are examples of the marginalized communities seeking state protection, seeking legal justice, seeking certain kinds of measures. So they are really looking to the government that they want some support, which is very true, that they really want the government which is ruling with the constitution to really protect them. They want reservation to be implemented. They want state to extend all the supports. These are very much there. So demanding the state to be responsible, to be democratic, is very much on the agenda. And it was very clear in the massacre situations in the universities that both the Dalits and OBC students, they were really demanding. In fact, we have demanded our vice chancellor that the university be run and it should not be closed because there is an anti-reservation agitation. Because our vice chancellor is happily closing and he is giving all these, for they used to have bus services. So 10-7 buses to students to go and wash Nehru statue near Ambedkar and near Abids and then come back in the evening. So every day they are doing this drama. So we said, no, the university as a responsible institution has to follow the constitution, you have to follow. That is very much there. But the more important fundamental question for me following from that was in relation to knowledge, in relation to self-understanding of these communities, as well as the larger domain of knowledge production. There, I think, the Mandal context and the atrocities context is very, very important. Whether in the form of, is there a national data on caste? How many OBCs are there in this country? Whether this country consists of caste groups? So which caste owns what? Whose caste is big in numbers? Which party's base is among the Dalits or among the OBCs? Among the whatever, who has been ruling this country? So who are the leaders of the communist parties? And it was revealed that the CPM had 9 state committee members, all are Kamma. So these kinds of revelations, it's a movement of revealing various things. It's a movement of new kind of an understanding at that point of time. It is also kind of a movement of the arrival of the new Dalit intellectuals. So that is the important point. The eraser of Dalit intellectuality was the historic kind of a crime. And that is where in the context of 90s, the arrival of the Dalit scholar, a lot of these issues come into force. If you take the two domains, one, the general public sphere, in the sphere of activism and outside society, and then the university, and you will really see what are the new kinds of things that happened. And you can really see that the Mandal and the Dalit movement provided a context to think of new kind of research agenda, new kinds of studies. And the first one would be recovering intellectual, philosophical, literary and religious traditions. In fact, with the colonial movement, then with the nationalist histories, our understanding was that there were these communities called untouchable communities, poor, marginalized, stigmatized, but they have been eternal slaves. For how many years? 3,000 years, 4,000 years. So they have nothing to claim. They have no history. They have no identity. They have not contributed to labor. They have not contributed to culture. They have not contributed to anything. Absolutely, they have nothing. They have no resources. We have to uplift them. So the task of the modern state is to uplift them. Uplift them and remove what is called the disabilities. The caste, for the term, the synonym for caste in some sense used in the constitution is disabilities. There are disabilities imposed on these people. We have to remove the disabilities. So they are seen in some sense as people with disabilities. They are not seen people with a mind, with a body, with a thinking, with capable of understanding society. So this was not. So by the time 70s, 80s, by the time the Indian social sciences and humanities well established, they are working with this assumption. The assumption that these people have nothing to claim. Somehow we have to help them. Somehow too we have to do a lot of empirical studies and see whether they are mobile, whether the policy is helping them or not, whether the elections are helping them or not, whether they are voting for this party and whether they are thinking that the other party, whether they are with the Congress or they are going to the regional parties. So this has been the focus of our studies. We have only been looking at them as vote banks. So you matter really as a vote bank. So you have never thought of them as people with skin and blood, with a mind and with the thinking of their own. So this is the problem. Then where is the question of thinking of them as intellectuals? So Dalit intellectuality is no question was not available. So the first time, it is not that there were no traditions, long historical traditions, where they were really, in fact, one student of mine today submitted a thesis on scroll painting of Telangana, based on Tulapurana. The first scroll painting available was 1625. The performers, they sing, they paint, and they interpret, and so on. They have created a tradition for well over 400, 500 years. So it is not that they are not capable of thinking. It is not that they are not capable of writing. It's not that they are not capable of performing. But it is our institutional domain. It is our disciplines that have blinded us to this. So this is where I think the importance of the arrival of the Dalit scholar and the Dalit movement becomes very, very important. The one glaring example is Ambedkar. Ambedkar, as though he was discovered in the 1990s, suddenly we all came to know that there was somebody called Ambedkar. Suddenly everybody said, oh, there was, in fact, I remember one very important seminar which happened in LHC. I don't know what it is called now. It used to be lecture hall complex. So then lecture hall complex, a very famous sociologist, you might know, S.R. Desai. So he came and he was talking about nationalism, because it was on his book, I think, Social Background to Indian Nationalism was his book. But he was talking about something. Then one person, today a very eminent person, asked one question to him. Sir, I have looked at your book, but there is no footnote to Ambedkar in your book. So do you think that Ambedkar even doesn't deserve a footnote in a book on social background to Indian nationalism? So this is the point that he asked. So here Lasset didn't have an answer. He said, is it? Did it happen? Oh no, Ambedkar was a Mahar leader. Ambedkar was not part of the national movement. Ambedkar was something, something and so on. He couldn't really answer all the wrong answers, again, wrong arguments. The person who asked the question was Kancha Aliya. Remember this. So that was the moment when really Ambedkar was discovered precisely by the Dalit movement and the Dalit scholars. And Ambedkar was only one example, the Pule and several other kind of long traditions. And Upendra Bakshi wrote an interesting, important kind of a piece. Because that was the time also the government decided that they will have the centenary celebrations of Ambedkar. Suddenly, they also discovered that he is Bharat Ratna. So said the Bharat Ratna will recognize him and then we will have a series of seminars. They started conducting a series of seminars. Then Upendra Bakshi made this very interesting observation. He wrote the first article in that memorial thing, which is there in our library also. You can take a look at it. Many Ambedkars is some kind of title. Where he spoke of the role of communities of knowledge and communities of power in the marginalization of Ambedkar. He said there has to be a debate now. What are the communities of power that have really suppressed? What are the communities of knowledge that have suppressed Ambedkar till now? He was accusing social sciences, he was accusing humanities, he was accusing the public university which has silenced Ambedkar for several years. So there is power politics involved in this. And in fact he called, his very title is the burning thoughts of Baba Sahib Ambedkar. So why are these burning thoughts of Baba Sahib Ambedkar not available till now? It is only now they are available and so on. So that was the context of Dalit studies. And in fact it led to a whole lot of discussion about the role of Gandhi, nationalism, rethinking Marxism, feminism, and in fact thinking of caste in the comparative context, global context, in the racial context, debating at Durban and other contexts. So it led to a huge explosion of this, but none of this kind of gets attention in the disciplines. You will not find many students working on these topics. They'll be working on all kinds of things, but they really don't take up this agenda. This agenda still remains a viral agenda of the Dalit students and students like Rohit. So that is the tragedy. That is where the relevance of Dalit studies. And then the other big example. Other big example is the rise of Dalit literature. Huge, very big, pan-Indian kind of a movement. And many think that it is a movement where they are saying, we have all these problems, why don't you help us? So this is one way of reading Dalit literature. That they are telling you that they have a lot of problems, they are weeping, somehow we have to help them. So please read Dalit literature, have a course on Dalit literature so that they will be happy. So this is how I think, so they try to read Dalit literature. So Dalit literature is also one of our Indian literatures. So at best, that is what we could do. But one of the things Dalit writers are saying is very important point that they're making is that it's not about what they're writing. It is also the claim that we have arrived as writers, as intellectuals, as people who can think and write of society very differently. We have very different things to say, whether you take it or not, we are a different set of writers and intellectuals. So it's a claim on the public, the huge battles. In the book, you have, I think, two articles on Telugu and Hindi. So the battle with Premchand, for example, the battle with Sri Sri, for example, the battle with the existing literary establishment itself is something of a story by itself. And it has to be written extensively. It was not written. It has to be written. It has to be documented. It has not been done sufficiently. That is why a new kind of a domain, a new kind of a field is something that you really have to think of. Then the second location is the university. Second issue is in terms of academic knowledge. This is all about happening outside. About Ambedkar, about Pule, about Dalit literature. This is all whole, the general public, the general Dalit community, the movement has taken it up as a task to write their own history, write themselves into the public memory of this. So they want to really write and do that. They have demonstrated it and they continue to do that. But what is happening in the academic domain? What is happening in the domain of academic knowledge? In fact, for the first time, it is a revelation, the Mandal also revealed something. Mandal also revealed for the first time that the university remained a caste Hindu space. In the university, you are not allowed to ask what are the communities who are ruling the university, both in administration and the academic administration, in the disciplines. Who are the socialists? What is their caste background? who are the sociologists, what is their gender background? So how many are there, how diverse are we? So these questions are not allowed to be asked. Mandal for the first time allowed, though it is about the OBC reservation, but it also allowed us to think of university as a space that has to be democratized. University remained very elite, very exclusive, and with dropout rate, and then now with suicide rate. So it remained exclusive, it has to be a democratic kind of a space. So then the scholars went on to look at other kinds of things. What is the kind of sociological knowledge that is available? What is the kind of historical knowledge that is available? What is this kind of political science that we are doing? In fact, one senior scholar from Usmania, in one of the seminars on Dalit studies, he's saying, Professor Srinivasulu, so I'm quoting because I will have his authority, he's saying that the political sciences have looked at historically again and again as Dalits as vote banks only. That was a major concern, who will they vote for, vote in the UP election. So they will have all these election surveys, heavy funding, they conduct and they study the voting behavior of the Dalits, but nothing else. They have not produced any political theory, Dalit political theory, or in fact if you look at even Ambedkar as a political thinker, you will have anthologies where you will have one or two articles. And everywhere Ambedkar is only presented in relation to Gandhi. He is as great as Gandhi or as good as Gandhi, but no independent status, no independent theoretical, political status is given within political science. So there may be some honorable exceptions, I am generalizing, but there may be one or two exceptions. More so after the 90s, but till the 90s, this was the same. And sociology was a disaster. Sociology was a disaster. The sociology, a discipline that studied, and this has been said again and again, studied Indian society, came up with the argument, the doyens of sociology came up with the argument that in India there is no caste, and with modernization, with political institutions and democracy, caste disappeared. We are a modern society. Sorry, we don't want to think of anything traditional. So this is what, so they have declared. They have declared and then they were really attacked and criticized by Dalits, saying that. So this is a very, very clear phenomenon. What is happening in the country now, either if you see the atrocities or you see the battles in the universities, and more so in the case of Rohit, sociologists have been thoroughly proved wrong. Thoroughly proved wrong, and their knowledge, their studies have been thoroughly discredited. Because they have studied social inequality, but they have not studied human dignity. Human dignity as one form of social dignity has not been formed the basis of any of the sociological kind of studies. And if you take up the history, history has a long kind of a tradition. Bangasar is here laughing, writing about Lambadas, but they have not written about Dalits. They have not written about Dalits, they have written about insurgents, they have written about peasants. The best of the radical historians wrote about peasants, but they have not written about Dalits. In fact, here in one of the papers in this volume, though I'm not promoting my volume, Ram Narayan Rawat has made this observation that the Dalit movement was frozen in historiography, that they were frozen as either scavengers or leather workers. So they go with the assumption that they're leather workers, and they'll find that they're leather workers. And in fact, he has gone into police intelligence reports, land revenue records, and various other kinds of material, and dug up and came with his understanding that they were a very important section of landlords at the point of time. The chamars in UP at that time, they were landlords and they were peasants. The small section was there as leather, but the leather stereotype of Dalit as chamar as the leather is something that the historians have contributed. Thank you, history discipline. So in fact, so this is the broad context. There are many things, but the rain is, it's not raining, so I'm going on. So this is where I thought the occasion is important, because the Rohit is more or less raising a similar kind of issue in the university. It is the issue of the Dalit intellectuality, Dalit imagination, their own. It's about a space where you can really imagine and do the kind of work that you want to do. So as an intellectual, they have no space and they really have to struggle. Because you are supporting Rohit, all of you have to struggle. Now you can't write your papers, you can't do your work in the laboratory, you all have to slog here, by now happily sitting at home watching the TV, 7 o'clock you will write your next paper, but you cannot do that. The university is not so a nice place now. So Rohit has created the struggle because you wanted to uphold the right of a Dalit scholar to be a scholar, then you have to suffer. You have to become non-scholar because of this. So So this is what I think our university is trying to do to the university, to all of us. So in some sense, so what is the central issue in this project? The central issue is the issue of the Dalit intellectuality. And in fact, the issue is not in terms of that there is something called already a field like Dalit studies. So there are various people growing. So if the Dalits are writing, there is Dalit history. It is not that way. It is a, in some sense, a project to be created. In fact, one of the Dalit writers in, for example, Tamil Nadu asked, in what ways Dalit writers are contributing to Dalit life? So I'm really asking you, in what ways Dalit scholars and other scholars contributing to make Dalit life richer and complex? Because you are the ones who have made it stereotypical. Who are the ones who made it simplistic? Who are the ones who really destroyed that life in public domain? In what ways are you going to represent this life in rich and complex manner? So that is where I think a domain like Dalit studies would be of some use. I mean, you can accept it and throw it, but definitely the issue is important. The issue is important in terms of how does one think of writing Dalit life in a rich and complex manner? How does one think of Dalit intellectuals as intellectuals of any kind, and intellectuals which actually know Dalit? In fact, Rohit's desire is that he would like to be a universal kind of a person. And in fact, in this context, I also wanted to mention the larger challenge posed in this present context. Is also the challenge is in terms of now, which I think the historian faced when the Babri Masjid incident happened. They faced this problem of whether there was a structure like that at a particular place. So they went to archaeology, said archaeologists said there was no Ram temple there. Historians said there was no evidence. They have written a kind of hundreds of books, tons of books, all our historians have really wrote and tried to see if there is any fact of Ram temple there in the site of Babri Masjid. So, but the challenge was much more serious. So they said, we believe that there was a Ram temple there. We just believe this is our faith. How does one deal with the faith? So that was the problem I think the historians are trying and have been trying hard to see how to challenge those modes of thinking. In fact, today, that mode is the mode of thinking about anything now. That mode is the mode of thinking of anything now. The mode of narratives, I don't know whether you hear this, that you create a narrative, then they will create a counter narrative, and they create another narrative. It's only about your narrative and their narrative. You say Rohit was discriminated, so Rohit was killed. They say something else. So nothing happened there. They are the anti-national activity. The anti-national activity trying to curb and so on. In fact, recently there was this incident on the campus. First I read the EFA that HCU students are taking a rally in support of one terrorist in Kashmir. That's what I read. So how are the students again doing? I was reading. So the next day the same paper says it was wrong. In fact, they were doing some memorial meeting for Karan Chedu, but some other guys and went and all that. So finally, the narrative is that all the papers carried this, that the University of Hyderabad students are defending the terrorist in Kashmir. So that was the narrative. So in fact, it's not accidental how that newspaper has got it, because the Andhra Jyoti people are not foolish people, but definitely these are planted. These stories are planted. There are people who are cooking and constantly writing these kinds of stories. And we have seen that when Ratnam and Lakshminarayan and myself have written this book on Ambedkar. When the RSS people have brought out a special issue, we try to produce a small booklet to counter them, to expose their lies. But they don't stop, they are really go on spreading these lies, repeating these lies. So really you have to take that challenge very seriously, because the problem is much deeper than we think. We may think that they are foolish, they are not. We may think that what they spread people don't believe, people would believe. And that's how from the Babri Masjid school, that is how they have come to this stage. To give you one example of Ambedkar, Ambedkar is such a figure where everything is written. And luckily, Vasant Mohan has sorted that everything is in print. And sorted that all the conferences, during the time of compilation, the RSS guys wanted to really put some more writings, saying that these are Ambedkar's writings. So he really went, and some speeches from BBC. He really went to BBC and got and verified and said, this is not Ambedkar's. So for us today, we have a very clear kind of amount of writing, and which is a clear kind of a writing, authenticated kind of writing by the authorities, by the best authorities possible. On such a figure, they can spread all this. And in fact, one day, this challenge is not even remote. The challenge is very, very immediate. one reporter from Bangalore, Hindu reporter, called me to say that there was this report I'm reporting, but I wanted to verify this for me. I said, what is it? That Ambedkar defended Sanskrit. Ambedkar wanted Sanskrit to be one of the subjects in the schools, and he proposed a resolution. That resolution was defeated, but it was proposed in such and such Constitution Assembly meeting. So this is the fact. So she said, can you verify this for me? Can you tell me? So I was completely shocked. I said, I didn't come across this anywhere. But since it is a challenge in terms of the fact, so I have to verify this. So both the volumes are available online. The proceedings of the Constitution and the writings are there. I have checked. I wasted my time. I was doing something. I wasted 2 days time. I found nothing. Then I thought, how are they doing this? What are the tricks that they're playing? Then you go online and search, put this line, it leads to a number of websites. And each website or each blog will have only one paragraph. Just says this, nothing else. And it leads to some TV discussions. Only the RSS representative says this, nobody else. And other guys don't counter this because that is not their point. They also thought, okay, maybe true, let's not get into this. So then this becomes somehow truth. Then I said, okay, you have a biographical piece on Wikipedia, which is a biographical entry on Ambedkar. Let me see that. Because quickly I wanted to think, I don't want to go and read the whole thing. I went there. In that, every entry is an RSS view. Whatever is there in the RSS journal, which we counted with Ratnam and me, all are there. I mean, when somebody contests, immediately some 10 people contest and put the same myth as a fact. And there it says, Ambedkar, in the same meeting, supported Sanskrit. And again, what is there, given a footnote. You go to the footnotes, it leads to some Swamiji's website. Only two lines are there, which says, Ambedkar said this. So this is the kind of thing that they're doing. So we really have to master some methodology to deal with these guys. This is done very systematic, deliberate kind of a manner. Can I take another 10 minutes? So then let me briefly say something about the volume and the project of Dalit studies, whether you call it a research agenda or whether you call it a kind of a collective. So I would like to really call it a collective, which would think of writing about certain issues which are not written in the academia, certain grey areas where you can really do something. So this is some kind of a collective of scholars who are committed to these kinds of issues. So in that sense, it's more of a pedagogic kind of a project. It's a project where if you want to be part of it, you can be part of it. If you can think of extending this project. Don't ask me, is there a Dalit studies, where is it happening, and so on. It is happening in the sense that it is happening in the teaching, it is happening in the research, in the form of courses at various places, but not in a very consolidated, systematic manner. Because what happens is that you have definitely a good number of studies, like I mentioned, Bangyas and several other studies, though they are kind of dispersed and they're everywhere. So within the history department, it is not valued and highlighted. Within the sociology, it will not be visible. So it has to be presented as something different. So that is where I think this new domain, especially to bring younger scholars, to provide space for debate, to provide space for thinking, provide space for new kinds of ways of writing history. So this is where we thought this idea of Dalit studies would be of some use. In fact, we did not begin with this idea, though I have been doing some of this for quite some time, but it so happened the conference was proposed as a Dalit studies conference in 2008. Then one of the interesting things that they have said, which would never happen in an Indian university, is that we would like scholars from the Dalit community to apply, and they would be in substantial number. So that was the interesting thing about this conference. Nowhere in any Indian conference, even today, they would say that. So they have really said that, and they have attracted very important scholars in this, and then this volume was produced. And for the first time we all met, we don't know each other actually. I never knew Sanal Mohan, I never knew Ram Narayan Rawat, I only knew Gopal Guru because he's everywhere. So I knew Jodhka, I knew Pandian I heard, but others I don't know. So all of them we met there. Then as the project was evolving, we thought it should be a project which would be ongoing. It should provide space for the younger scholars who are writing new kind of stuff. It could be a series of volumes. It doesn't have to be a single volume. No point complaining sociologists are not doing. No point complaining historians are not doing. they are doing what they are doing. If there are one or two guys, they are doing something. So we have to do something. So in fact, this is how this idea started. So there are parallel examples one could think of. Because this desire is there, that there has to be a location, there has to be a space. And that desire is very much there, which is illustrated by Explosion Center set up by Torrent. And Torrent has said this in a number of meetings, that the existing social sciences are not addressing certain concerns. So that is why exclusion studies, whether it is failure or not, but it has come with that kind of a desire. So when I propose something like Dalit studies as a new kind of a research agenda, an inquiry, I'm not proposing as, in fact, I would like to refer to some of the comments of the reviewers. In Delhi, there was a panel on this book. So Satish Deshpande made this observation that it is a historic kind of an intervention. The fact that there are several now Dalit scholars in various departments, and then it is some kind of a consolidated expression that they would like to pursue certain kind of new agenda. So it is in the time, in the air, that this kind of a thing comes. But he says that it also has this demand that it is demanding recognition within the institutional domain of academia. So it is very true that it is within the institutional domain that you are making this demand, but certainly not as a department or a paper to be introduced and so on. It has to be a critical kind of a space, and whatever period that it continues, it has to be there. And in fact, why this kind of particular collective? Because the larger issue that has opened up, not only Dalit intellectuality as people who would like to be recognized and represented in the university and so on, but also the shift from welfare, legal justice, protection to larger claims. Claims on civilization, claims on history, claims on knowledge. So this is an important shift, and Rohit represents that shift. Rohit was not asking for smaller things. He was asking that he should be allowed to be a scientist, allowed to be a scholar. So this shift in the thinking of the Dalit, in the thinking of the marginalized communities, is very, very important. The climb to civilization, the climb to history, the climb to dignity, money, positions, reservations, all are there, all are implemented or not, but this is a kind of a new claim. A claim, if you would like, as Ambedkar would say, to reclaim the complete human personality, this claim is important. If you want to claim Dalit as a complete human personality, so this is important. This is a new kind of a domain is important. Here, if you look at the book, interestingly, we didn't anticipate this, that the book is about nationalism versus dignity. That is the thing. Nationalism versus the caste. If you look at, starting with Gopal Guru, which is actually saying that nationalism is a serious problem. And Gopal's first article is at length talks about the problem with the nationalist understanding. In fact, the problem with both the historical tension between the nationalist and Ambedkar, nationalist and the Dalits, that the Dalits have a different understanding of colonialism, that the Dalits have a different relationship with the nationalism. They were never nationalist. They would never like to be part of nationalism because it is bourgeois, it is upper caste, it is only worried about the humiliation of Gandhi and Nehru's. So there was a huge tension. So the Gopal Guru's problem is not both a problem of the past and also of the present. What is the present problem? The present problem is that you have a Sarvajan model. You have a new kind of a scholarship from sympathetic scholars. Both of them are trying to more or less portray Dalits as nationalists. That in 1887 revolt, Dalits were there. Therefore, they are part of the history. So we were also nationalists. So Gopal Guru finds it extremely difficult to accept that Dalits have never been nationalists of that kind, and please don't write this kind of history, saying that they were also part of this, they were also aligned with Gandhi, they were also somewhere else. So this restoration, this co-option, and this discovering Dalits in the nationalist lab is something that is not acceptable. And again saying the following is the logic, we were also Sarvajan. We were all part of everybody. So we were not separate. You have been historically seen as separate and different. And suddenly now within the Sarvajan, you are going to be co-opted. So this co-option is absolutely problematic because it doesn't give you dignity. Human dignity is not guaranteed within these models. And in fact, you have other two articles on Dalit history. Very interesting things happened. I think I would like to say this in relation to what Professor Madhav Prasad was saying yesterday about those two articles about history. So is there anything new in this book in terms of thinking of methods and so on? He's saying very interesting point. The interesting point is that that looks like that there are these field reports, intelligence reports, and survey reports, and all those are there. Those are there earlier, those are there now. But looks like now there is a completely different way of reading these things. So why is this happening? In fact, someone like Ranjit Guha has looked at these police reports and tried to see what is behind this narrative. He tried to unravel what happened. If you want to read this narrative, what happened behind, and what was the politics, and how they suppressed peasants, and so on. So Madhav Prasad was saying, it looks like Guha was not reading what is there in the report. The literal is not there. He was looking for the metaphorical. That was interesting. In the metaphorical, he could see the peasant revolt, but he did not see the literal. In the literal, is something that he is missing. So in fact, he says that there is something interesting in this kind of a new kind of a way of looking at it. It is both looking at the same thing, but looking for something new. But also, it is also thinking of the look of the looking at. The gaze of the looking at. How you have looked at it. What is the problem with that, and what is also not seen, and what is seen now. So he says that there is a certain kind of possibility by revisiting the colonial archive, by looking at the Chamar histories and the Dalit Christians in Kerala. And in fact, the Saran Mohan makes this important, very, very important, interesting observation that colonial modernity is something that enabled Dalits. The intention is not that the colonial state wants to do something, but it so happened that it opened up certain kind of public domain. It opened up a social space. Within that social space, Dalits have made their moves, then they made their initiatives. In fact, what really enabled them was not the colonial policy of land revenue or their own whatever. What really enabled them was that the normative rule of law, where for the first time, the slaves, the untouchables were slaves, were told that they were a human beings with pain and blood. Because when they were wounded, they tried to treat them, they tried to give them some medicine, they tried to clean the wound, and they told them that you are human beings, you are not animals. So the Christian discourse really enabled them. From there the Dalit journey starts. It's not that the Christianity liberated them, the Dalit journey starts from there. So there are stories of that kind in this. And I'll stop with there are a lot more issues. I will go on like this because I'm passionate about it, but you may get bored. So I have two issues that I would like to talk about. One is the very idea of Dalit itself. And many young people ask me, so there is a Madhiga movement, there are different kinds of caste groups doing all this. So what is the value of Dalit? Value of Dalit, that is one kind of an issue. So in terms of, then second issue, in terms of the new kind of thinking on caste that the Dalits have brought into the discussion. With these two points, I think I'll stop and then we can discuss further. So the Dalit is not an empirical category. Dalit doesn't refer to anybody. So Dalit is a conceptual category. Dalit is an abstract, theoretical kind of a category that was evolved in the Dalit movement. Evolved as a movement, as an identity of mobilization. And it really enabled so many things. And in fact, if you look at Rohit Vemula's struggle, Dalit or not Dalit is at the core of this. And I'm really surprised, the JNU guys, I told them also in one of the conferences, that Raja's daughter, who was also a left student, and Kanaya, all of them start saying, some of them, we are also Dalit. Mishra wrote an article saying that I am a Dalit, I am Raja's daughter, something like that. I said, it's good that the Dalit as a category is speaking to you now. So far you are only a Marxist. So Dalit is a kind of a pedagogic category that many people can take shelter under this and think of this as a critical viable category. So it's good that it is taking this new life. And you have, on the other hand, Venkaiah Naidu suddenly commissioning people write articles in various newspapers. So where he says that Rohit is not a Dalit because he is a communist. Rohit is not a Dalit because he is a Maoist. So all the Maoists are not Dalits. So on the other side. So who are Dalits? Dalits who are not Maoists, Dalits who are not modern, Dalits who are not Ambedkar are Dalits. So basically Hindus are Dalits. So there is a certain kinds of discussion going on, which is very interesting to think of. And the only way that the BJP guys can get into this is only by saying specific caste groups and mobilize them. So Ayyangar is a Pulaya leader. Or somebody is a... So pick up those kind of leaders, they cannot enter the field of Dalits because they will be really finished in that field. It's very, very, very difficult there. So it is also a complex and evolving category where Rohit has contributed something here. On the one hand, Madhya government has contributed saying that identity is not unified, it is also split within, and it has to be thought. It has to be thought how it speaks to the universal, how it also mobilizes various kinds of communities, how it addresses internal inequalities, how it addresses gender inequalities. So that is the challenge that they opposed. Rohit has brought in the idea of the patron lineage. What is the lineage of this Dalit category? Is it a male category? The category decided by the father's caste? So this is the challenge that Rohit has posed. It's a category with a possibility. So this has to be really pursued, which is at the center of Dalit study. Then in terms of understanding on caste, so the sociological understanding of caste as something that is known. We know it. It is a structure. In fact, you have people that are drawing pictures. Brahman on the top, and there is a ladder, one after the other. So there is a known structure. Then it is hierarchical, and you have to break it. Then everybody becomes normal. So this is the kind of... So it's a known structure. This structure which can be manipulated and changed and so on and so forth. So this is a kind of a... But it is only a structure that we all are outside it. We look at the structure and say how to break it. This is how it is. But the Dalit says that we are very much within it. And each of you have your own identity. Each of you are there in the ladder. Each of you are also benefiting from this. So it is also an identity. It is also an identity. It is also a representation. It has to do with your privilege and the way that you are constituted, the way that you have accesses and so on. It has been much more fundamentally subjective. You cannot make it as an obvious structure and I am going to demolish it. So it is very much part of us, and how does one deal with this? So this is a challenge that they really have posed in terms of the discussion on caste. And not only that, caste today is not actually a structure, but is a site where all the battles are happening. It is a site where you are actually negotiating for positions. So the Rohit... Discussion around Rohit about the identity is very, very important, because if the caste is a fixed thing that you know it, then there is no controversy around Rohit. The controversy around Rohit tells you that Dalits are able to manage and manipulate, demolish the discussion and take it to a new level. Thank you.
Thank you, Satyanarayana, for that simple speech. You are all part of this open space academics, as we have termed it, or street academics, whatever. Okay, so there is no difference between the people and the actors here. And now you can respond to Satyanarayana, you can ask questions, or if you want to come and sing a song, you can sing, no problem. Anything that you know, you... and participate in this discussion. I think Satyanarayana can take a few questions, and any other way you want to respond, you can respond.